remembering back in the middle of the 19th century, essentially all urban residents were reliant upon walking for transportation. So the streetcar evolves very slowly out of a transportation effort to provide a means through which people could move through an expanding city. First, we're just talking about wagons being pulled by horses. Eventually, that simple technology evolves into something that's more complicated, more comfortable for passengers. Essentially, it was the same type of car that had been pulled by a horse, now just hooked up to electricity. These streetcars allowed people to move much greater distances. They could travel more reliably, faster, and a little bit more inexpensively, so a larger percentage of Cincinnati residents could use them on a regular basis to get to and from work and to go into the middle of the city. They don't compete well with streets filled with automobiles. So by the 1920s, as we have more and more people, particularly folks who live farther out, instead of relying on the trolley, buying their own cars, the number of folks who are interested in getting rid of streetcars begins to outnumber the number of people who are still reliant on streetcars for their primary means of commuting around the city.
You know, those streetcars were in operation for decades. So it was a lasting success. In fact, actually, they were to the point where they needed to be reinvested in. But instead of being rebuilt, they were dismantled. And that had a lot to do with GM's Charlie Wilson. Obviously, he had the mentality of a car manufacturer and thought, well, the real American dream is your little 2-acre plot or 1-acre plot in the suburbs. But we're seeing the pendulum swing back the other way.
The idea behind the modern streetcar focuses on the concept of transit-oriented development. Cities like Portland, Oregon have seen firsthand the revitalizing effects such a system can bring. Since the introduction of the streetcar system, $3.5 billion has been invested in the area, equaling over 10,000 new housing units and 5.4 million square feet of office, institutional, retail, and hotel construction within 2 blocks of the alignment.
When you have a streetcar in place, what you do is you unlock the potential of a higher density built environment. And that translates to substantial additional real estate investment, which means more property taxes are paid, more jobs are generated, more payroll taxes are paid, more sales taxes are paid because retail gets more energy when you have people going by. And it also unlocks the potential for people who prefer to live in a high density urban environment. And Cincinnati is a great urban environment. It's inexpensive to live there. There's lots of job opportunities. It's a beautiful city. It's got great arts and culture. I think that's really why we're pursuing it. It hits a lot of points. It attracts young people. It makes the city more livable. It makes the city greener. It helps reduce traffic congestion, helps encourage density in areas that are already dense, which maximizes the infrastructure investment you've already made.
Today, there are over 40 cities across the U.S. who are studying, developing, building, or operating streetcar systems. In the last decade or so, there has been a renewed interest in Cincinnati's urban core. Since 2000, downtown residents have doubled and are expected to increase another 4,000 by 2011. A city feasibility study in 2007 concluded the streetcar project would have a $1.4 billion economic impact, as it helps spark residential and commercial redevelopment on blighted and vacant properties along the route. Currently, the proposed route for Phase 1 would start from the river, move through downtown and across Central Parkway into over the Rhine. Phase 2 would add an additional line up Vine Street, connecting downtown to the uptown area, the university, and surrounding hospital. As with any issue, the streetcar proposal has the city somewhat divided.
This is something that, especially at this time, the taxpayers can't afford to fund. We're living in a city and a county that can't keep a jail open because they can't afford to staff it. And you want to spend $200 million on a fixed rail system when you already have buses that handle the same routes. Well over a year ago, the city council authorized Milton Dehoney to go out and get private donations for a streetcar. These are people that are going to benefit from it. These are businesses that are going to benefit from it. And as of yet, the only business that has given is Duke Energy. If this is such a great plan that's going to benefit downtown, it's going to benefit productivity, going to benefit people living downtown, you would think those that are involved with it would want to support it. The government's role should not be to to stimulate the economy. The government's role should be to get out of the way and let the American entrepreneur get in there. And the reason you have the problems in Over the Rhine is because of government control. The city of Cincinnati has passed so many laws and building ordinances. When people actually want to go in and fix those things up, they can't because they're hamstrung by the laws. It makes everything much more expensive than actually going outside the city and investing in those neighborhoods.
A lot of people in Cincinnati are resistant to change. But if you look at the facts, it's really hard to argue the numbers. This is a very intelligent investment to make, particularly in a time when we are struggling so much to make sure that we're protecting our economic base. It's worth doing because of what the complexity of it really reveals, which is how people choose to live. I mean, this really just comes down to people. Do people want to live in Cincinnati? How can we encourage them to do it? Streetcar is about creating that energy, and it's different, it's new. That's really the magic behind a streetcar, and the numbers have been vetted carefully. And the proof really is in the pudding when you look at the results in these other cities.
Now, I think there is an open question of whether or not the money that one would put into a streetcar is actually being spent the best way. I mean, there's no way you're going to ever figure out what $100 million should be spent on what capital investment to get the most bang for your buck. Building a streetcar system is more than just putting the rails in the streets and buying a few streetcars that can run around on them. I think you really do have to change the nature of the streets themselves that they run on. This is a sign that you're a progressive community, that you expect to grow. It's kind of a badge of honor when at this moment in time when people are thinking that being a large and thriving city is of value, right? Which isn't always the case, as we can tell.
Strong, grab me by the heartstrings and pull.